What does listening to the sound of crickets have to do with the psychological theories of Sigmund Freud? We'll find out in today's episode. Hello, welcome to another episode of It's Not What You Think. In this episode, we're going to explore the sounds of insects and how insect sounds can be incorporated into music. But first, it's now time for 1001 Coffees. This is where each episode I have a different coffee, perhaps a different flavor, or perhaps a different brand of coffee, and eventually, hopefully, achieving 1001. So this week, we have Wonka. Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. Come on. You gotta taste anything that says Willy Wonka, you gotta try it. And so, we're trying Willy Wonka from International Delight. It's the Whipple Scrumptious Fudgy Caramel. Oh, come on. Sounds great. Okay, and we have our coffee, our currently black coffee. I chose the Smoky Midnight. I thought the dark, rich flavor would go well with the fudgy caramel. We made it 2 scoops in our short stories single serving coffee maker, and then now let's pour in the Willy Wonka's Whipple Scrumptious Fudgy Caramel. I love the name of that, Whippy Scrumptious, and I'm gonna make sure I get plenty of it in there so it comes right out. The curious part, when I think of fudgy caramel, I think of a dark colored liquid. But when this came out, it was pure white, like cream, the color of cream. And it certainly makes the coffee change to that caramelly color that you were familiar with, cream and coffee. And it's a nice cup of coffee. I have to say, I don't taste as much chocolate or caramel in it as I thought I would. It's not a slap in the face of fudge and caramel. It's a nice coffee flavor with a hint of caramel. And that's actually how I like my coffee. But it's different than what I expected. I expected it would taste like drinking a candy bar, but it's not. It tastes like a cup of coffee that has a little shot of flavoring of fudge and caramel. So there's our Willy Wonka Whipple Scrumptious Fudgy Caramel. And now, 1001 t-shirts. This is where someone gives me a t-shirt and my compliments and thanks, I wear it for the episode. And here we have today, Flu Survivor of 2018. That's right, that's me. I'm a flu survivor of 2018. Remember 2018, that flu that year was really, really intense. My sister sent me this shirt because I got the flu twice in 2 months. I'm pretty sure if my memory is correct, I got it once in December, and then again the following February, and wow, man, did it knock me for a loop, especially that second time. Not sure why. It was just an awfully intense flu that year, and so my family decided to poke fun at me and sent me a t-shirt, and my brother sent me a pandemic kit. This is before COVID now. And then my other brother sent me a book, How Not to Die. And my father sent me a case of water to keep hydrated. And so there was loving support as well as some jovial good humor. There you have it. Flu Survivor 2018. And now it's time for the development of Western music. We've come a long way in exploring pure sound and how that sound gets incorporated into composed music, started with the Big Bang, moved into DNA, and then the various sounds of the planet, earth, air, water, fire, metal, wood. Today, we move into living beings. We move into the sounds of insects, crickets, and cicadas, and beetles, and all sorts of crawly things. Let's start off just listening to pure sound, an evening of crickets. So one thing I've come to notice, I bet you have as well, is that nature likes white noise. I mean, the sound of space. The sound of earth. The sound of the ocean. The sound of a geyser or jet stream, natural jet stream. Right? The sound of insects. It's all white noise. And so a little bit of research, we do find nature relaxing. We tend to find that it relaxes us and allows us to fall asleep. So a little bit of research, I came up with a quote from Dr. Itara, who says that white noise exposure gradually decreases levels of inhibition, resulting in cells that are unable to stop responses. Okay, now, if we were to examine this, white noise gradually decreases levels of inhibition. So inhibition is up here. You can maybe consider that stress. And then it decreases levels of inhibition. And so let's change the wording from levels of inhibition to psychological defenses. We'll get psychological now. Resulting in cells that are unable to stop responses. Let's use the word repress. Let's substitute that for repress. Now we get a similar concept with different wordings, more of a psychological. White noise exposure gradually decreases psychological defenses, resulting in cells that are unable to repress responses. Now, I'm not changing the meaning. I'm only clarifying the meaning by giving it different words. Wow. No wonder you feel energized. You feel relaxed and energized when you're exposed to nature, when you're exposed to the, I'm calling it white noise of nature sounds. The bees, the crickets, the ocean. David Rothenberg is a professor of philosophy and music, and he specializes, or he has a special interest in animal sounds and incorporating them into music. He has an album called Bug Music, in which he takes live recordings, and in fact, I don't think he takes recordings, I think he plays with the insects. If I recall, he has in his studio, or he goes somewhere where there's large quantities of insects making all sorts of chatter, and then he plays the clarinet with the sounds of the insects. David Rothenberg expands and joined forces with accordion player Pauline Oliveros and throat singer Timothy Hill to form a trio of cicada-inspired music. This episode to bring you another chocolate challenge. This week's chocolate challenge, we discovered a candy bar, a white chocolate candy bar of 26% cocoa. And we thought we would be able to fool our contestant. I gave my friend David a bite of a milk chocolate bar, 25% cocoa, versus the white chocolate bar, 26% cocoa. Hoping he will think that the milk chocolate, since it is darker in color, has more cocoa than the white chocolate bar. Let's find out if we were able to fool him. Okay, I'm here with my friend David.
And yeah.
David's gonna take the chocolate challenge.
Okay.
All right, David. So we have two pieces of chocolate.
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna ask you to eat each one,
mm-hmm.
and then I'll ask you a question.
All right.
And hopefully stump you.
Okay. Rich fruity accent. No. All right.
And you can eat the whole piece or...
Just got something crunchy in it?
Yeah. Little bits of toffee.
Hmm. Well, not always the biggest chocolate guy, but it's good.
You're not a big chocolate guy?
Yeah, but the, you know, I always like your crackles, your crunches of the world,
mm-hmm.
stuff like that. So, basically, all right, try to try this?
Yeah, go for it.
I'm always a bigger fan of white chocolate, usually.
Well, for real. I've never met someone who's a big fan of white chocolate or other chocolates.
If it's been done well, this is done, you know, this is fairly typical. But whoever made this was better.
Okay, now, here's the challenge.
Mm-hmm.
You know how they post on the front of chocolate bars the percentage of cocoa?
Mm-hmm.
Which one has a higher cocoa? First one you ate or the second one you ate?
It's hard to know.
Yeah, it is. That's why this is a challenge.
And
if you win, I'll let you have another piece.
Knowing the way these things are supposed to go
mm-hmm.
Changes my assessment to mm-hmm. possibly suggest that maybe it was the white chocolate rather than the dark chocolate.
You think the white chocolate is what?
Has
a higher percentage of cocoa?
Just in terms of, I've been been tricked enough times that I would suspect that.
All right, well, why don't you look?
All right. So let's see. We have milk chocolate with salted toffee from Great Value Walmart, and white chocolate created for bakers by Dr. Oetker. Ah! And let's see.
It's on the front.
It's on the front. So, cocoa solids, 25% minimum. And this is...
cocoa butter, 26%.
Cocoa butter, 26%.
So you're right. The white chocolate is more. Congratulations.
Yeah. Well, that's, you know, this is serious, like, baking chocolate versus, you know, just whatever.
Yeah.
But not that much of a difference. Hard to tell from the taste, but, you know, just parsing it out from the trickiness of these endeavors.
Right on. Thanks for participating.
No worries.
Oh, foiled again. We weren't able to fool David, but we'll try again next time. There's an experimental music group called the Tribes of Nero. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing it correctly. N-E-U-R-O-T. How would you pronounce it? I went with Nero. And this experimental music group incorporates a lot of ambient sounds and atmospheres. And on their album, Adaptation and Survival, they take recorded sounds of insects, and then they alter it a little bit. They transmute it and turn it into just this wonderfully ambient, auric source of sound play. Their first track is just 2 minutes long. Let's give it a listen. So we go from listening to crickets, we go to playing musical instruments along with the crickets, we go to taking the sounds of crickets and altering them. Of course, the next step would be playing music to imitate the sounds of bugs or insects, and I think that goes well beyond the scope of this episode. I can't even think of a particular piece that imitates the sound of insects off the top of my head. But in any event, I think we have come to a conclusion in this week's episode. I hope you have a good time and a good week. And I don't know why I said a good time.